if you are a 5th edition Dungeon Master, and you are, and you think, wow, you know, combat is starting to get kind of boring, or you feel like it's difficult to challenge your players, this video is for you. Let's imagine you've been playing 5th edition for a year or a year and a half by now, and your players have gotten to be about 15th or 16th level, and they're pretty powerful. Let's give the group a name completely at random. Let's call them Pox Machina. They've been adventuring for the past several months, leading up to a big battle that they are prepared for against an ancient red dragon named Sordak. Unless you have a lisp, in which case his name is pronounced in a completely different manner. And you look at the red dragon in the monster manual and you think, yeah, this guy is pretty tough. Let's see how it works. But you're a round or two into the battle and you start thinking, gosh, I wish this ancient red dragon, who is sort of a avatar of fire, you know, had more cool stuff to do, more interesting ways to challenge the players. Of course, you have the option of letting your dragons cast spells. That is a well-documented feature in the monster manual. You can do that. I have done it, and it is effective, but it is somewhat tedious because you're grafting an entire other game system, spellcasting, onto something that's already of, you know, medium difficulty. Wouldn't it be interesting, and certainly more challenging, if because Sordak is a ancient avatar of fire, he's called the Lava Lord, let's say. Sordak, the Lava Lord, has a certain reputation and is obviously a fire-based creature. So what if just standing within 25 feet of Sordak caused you to take 20 points of damage a round, and there was no saving throw, and it didn't have to hit? It just radiates fire, and you do not want to be near this thing. It's a very simple thing to do, and it really makes this dragon a lot more threatening and I think, more interesting. I mean, ultimately, I think dragons in D&D are first and foremost large bags of hit points with breath weapons. If you want to run a monster, obviously, that's got lots of different crazy abilities, you use something like a beholder. But I'm not the only person that thinks that dragons in 5th edition are somewhat boring, and this is a way to make them a little bit more interesting. It's got a breath weapon, of course, but you think, gosh, it'd be neat if this breath weapon did a little bit more than just did damage. What might it do? How about if Sordak, the Lava Lord's fire breath, not only did damage, but if you failed your saving throw, it negated all of your fire resistance for the rest of the battle? That would be interesting, and the kind of thing that can change the tide of battle. It can take the heroes from thinking that they have the upper hand to suddenly feeling as though maybe they need to rethink their strategy. His breath is supernaturally powerful. He is an avatar of fire. When he hits you with his fire breath, if you fail your save, he burns away your fire resistance. You can imagine the dialogue he would have before he breathed on you. He would say something like, "Your mortal spells are no match for my flame." And the players will be wondering, what is he talking about? Well, they're gonna find out. Of course, our ancient red dragon has frightful presence. Wouldn't it be more interesting if that frightful presence was a little bit more frightful? For instance, if you fail your saving throw against the frightful presence, you are frightened until you save, and then, once you do save, you are shaken, which gives you disadvantage to your attack rolls until you save. In other words, you were frightened, you got over it, but you are still shaken for at least a little while. That would certainly make this ancient red dragon feel as though it were a supernatural presence. Of course, our dragon has fire breath. That's very useful if you're standing in the cone in front of it when it breathes, but wouldn't it be interesting if it could use its fire breath in another way and get another kind of attack out of it? Instead of breathing in an area in the people in front of it, it immolates a specific person within, let's say, 100 feet. It focuses its breath in a line and burns one person that's relatively far away, and that helps it target people who are ranged or flying or otherwise trying to avoid the fire breath. Also, since it's focusing its fire, literally focusing its fire on a single target, the fire would be stronger, and therefore, once you take damage, you are on fire. Until you save, of course, let's not be ridiculous. Now our ancient red dragon is starting to be a little bit cooler, and I don't think any more difficult or complex to run. Certainly these abilities, you just make notes on the character sheet, you don't have to spend all your time looking up spells. We've made only 3 changes so far. We've said if you stand within 25 feet of it, you're taking damage every round. Maybe it doesn't have to be 20 damage, maybe it's 10 damage or 15 damage. That's up to you, you're the dungeon master. We gave its frightful presence an after effect that makes it a little bit more frightening. And we gave him another way to use his fire breath that allows him to target a single individual that can be at great range and set them on fire. That may be enough, but just for good measure, let's give him one more interesting ability. Once the heroes have reduced Sordak, the Lava Lord, to half hit points, he flies into a rage and immediately reacts. Woe betide whichever adventurer dropped our ancient red dragon to half hit points. Because the dragon's breath weapon at that point immediately recharges and he uses it. That's an interesting mechanic because the fire breath on a dragon has a recharge. I think recharge is a great mechanic, but you've got to roll a 5 or 6. It's possible, especially given that in any given combat, the bad guy's life expectancy is only about 5 rounds. It's possible that he only get to use his breath weapon once. This way, by giving Sordak the Lava Lord the ability once he drops to half hit points to instantly recharge and use his breath weapon, we are assured that the players are going to get to see that breath weapon happen at least twice. And the fact that it's happening as a reaction when it's not the player's turn can be devastating. because it's the kind of thing they're not prepared for. It's a surprise. I think at this point, you're probably having one of two reactions. You're either thinking, that is crazy, you're insane, or that is crazy, I want to do it. If you're having the second reaction, this video is for you. This is the fourth edition video. This is the video where we talk about all the cool stuff in fourth edition that they have since thrown out that we are free to steal. I steal from fourth edition all the time. All those things that we just talked about, all those abilities are all things I stole from fourth edition. They're all just the normal way of fourth edition Ancient Red Dragon works. I often have people online in my videos, on Twitter, on my subreddit, saying, combat has gotten boring and it's hard to challenge the players, what do you do? And the answer is, I steal stuff left and right from 4th edition. And interestingly, my players have never played 4th edition, so they don't know that. Often when I give my players interesting titles, or I give them interesting weapons, the abilities in those titles or those weapons come from the abilities from 4th edition. Toward the end of the video, we're going to get to the history of 4th edition, but I wanted to front load all the cool stuff first, so you might watch this video for 5 or 10 minutes and say, I'm sold, where's the 4th edition monster manual? And you won't have to watch the rest of the video. I like making sure that all the best advice is front loaded into the beginning of the video. We're also going to have to spend a little time talking about why things work the way they do in 5th edition, and this I think will be some useful advice. Mechanics is something I've avoided up until now just because I want my advice in these videos to be evergreen. I want it to be useful for anyone running Dungeons & Dragons and really anyone running an RPG. For instance, let's get started. One of the things about 5th edition that if you know it will affect how you run combat is that because of the action economy in 5th edition, because of something called bounded accuracy, or I usually refer to it as flattened math, whichever side in a battle in 5th edition has the most people on it, that side has a significant advantage. For instance, a group of 5 bad guys against 4 heroes, the 5 bad guys, because they outnumber the good guys, they have a greater than 20% advantage. This isn't immediately obvious, but it's because of a principle of the design of 5th edition called bounded accuracy. You can look up bounded accuracy, but it's a result of the playtesting and the surveys they did during playtesting. They asked people, how do you wish D&D worked? And one of the things people said they wanted was, they wanted low-level bad guys to still be interesting and useful at medium and higher levels. How do you do that? Well, 5th edition's answer was to make sure that the math doesn't change that much from level to level. Whatever your armor class or bonus to hit is at first level, it's probably going to be the same at second level and third level, and it'll go up when you get a magic item, but we'll talk about that in a second. Magic items in 5th edition are intended to be rare. Eventually, your proficiency modifier goes up, but your stats don't go up that much. So apart from stuff like blessings and finding magic items, your bonus to hit is basically your bonus to hit for a long time. Your armor class isn't going to go up much. Your hit points go up every level, so a group of goblins is more dangerous to you at first level than it is at, say, third or fourth level, but those goblins are still dangerous. The reason they were dangerous at first level is because one hit from a goblin could conceivably kill a weak character. Now, that won't be true once the player's at fourth or fifth level because they'll have so many more hit points. But even then, a whole bunch of goblins fighting the heroes, the goblins are still going to have, because the hero's armor class hasn't gone up that much, the goblins are still going to have a 20 to 30% chance of hitting, and over time, that makes a difference. That's one of the design principles of 5th edition, is that any given attack should have a 30 to 40% chance of succeeding. So this is a useful thing to know as a D&D dungeon master, and it's one of the first things I tell new DMs that I know in person. I say, just remember, anytime the players are outnumbered, the odds that things are going to go against them grow significantly. This is also true in reverse. If there's many heroes, an entire party of heroes, going up against one solo bad guy, the heroes have an advantage. I mean, all other things being equal, the players have a huge advantage because they get so many more actions. One of the reasons the math is flat, I'm basically going to say the same thing but from the other direction. One of the reasons the math is flat is because they expect a heroic PC to hit about 60-65% of the time because missing isn't that much fun, and the way they can ensure that will happen is by keeping armor classes low. This is relevant to us as dungeon masters because if we're trying to challenge our players, just increasing the monster's armor class is contrary to the design of 5th edition. Because really all you're doing is making it so the players miss more often, and that's not fun. It's frustrating. Players like hitting, and D&D 5 assumes they're going to hit a lot, so armor classes don't go up that much. Attack bonuses don't go up that much. Instead, what happens to go up a lot is hit points. It would be nice, therefore, if there was a way to challenge the players when I intend them to go up against one big bad guy. I know out of the gate the heroes have an advantage because they get so many more actions. How can I even the odds somewhat? The answer is I give the bad guy lots of minions. Minions are something 4th edition invented, and then 5th edition threw out, and I really like minions. For instance, using the example of Sordak the Lava Lord, let's give him a whole bunch of salamander minions. I say salamander, I don't mean these things, I mean these things. Salamanders are in the monster manual, they're a 5th level bad guy. And you're thinking, wow, Matt, this is going to be a pain in the butt, you've just increased the amount of work I have to do because now I have to run all these salamanders. But actually, in 4th edition, a salamander minion is different than a normal salamander. A normal salamander that you would fight at 5th level has 90 hit points, but when you're 16th level and the salamanders are minions working for Sordak, the Lava Lord, they have one hit point. It has all the same stats as a regular Salamander. It's just as likely to hit, which, given that they're plus 7 to hit, means even if you have an armor class of 21 or 22, still means there's like a 35% chance the Salamander is going to hit. And if you have a bunch of them and they can get flanking, now they have advantage. All sorts of crazy stuff starts to happen. But you're only tracking that one attack they make per round. And as soon as the player does any damage to them, the Salamander dies. So you're not tracking any damage. And that makes the characters feel heroic. That feeling of wading through a sea of bad guys is epic. And while the bad guys live, they challenge the players in a more effective way than just one solo bad guy. As 4th edition went on, they made sure that if you were a solo elite, they had categories of different kinds of monsters, which I thought was super useful. And we're starting to see a little bit of that now with Volo's Guide to Monsters. If you were fighting a solo elite bad guy, which meant literally this thing by itself is meant to take on an entire party, they would make sure that this monster could do many things on the player's turn. And that's kind of where legendary actions come from. I use minions all the time. I think minions are great, and I'm not sure why they killed them from 5th edition. I'm sure they had reasons. I mean, technically, given how much damage higher level characters do, you could have a regular goblin in a fight against a bunch of 7th level heroes, and it's the fact that goblins have 7 hit points, for these heroes, that's no different than having 1 hit point. But when I originally started running D&D like that with 5th edition, I noticed that sometimes the players would do so little damage that my normal monster would not be treated like a minion and would live, and that became more bookkeeping than I wanted to do, so I just started using minions. Some people think minions are silly. Some people think the idea that an ogre might only have 1 hit point, an ogre minion, is ridiculous, but that there, I think, I didn't have a problem with that because you only deploy an ogre as a minion when the players are like 16th level. At that point, they're doing so much damage and they're so much more competent. They're becoming legendary characters. They have so many supernatural abilities that the thing that challenged them when they were 5th or 6th level is now a minor nuisance. I say minor nuisance, but an ogre minion, throwing an ogre against a group like Pox Machina would still be a big deal, even if it only had 1 hit point, if there was a bunch of them. Because it has a high bonus to hit and it does a lot of damage. Give it a shot. Try it. Try using minions and you'll see what I mean. Don't overdo it, just use a handful of them, and you'll see that once you have more bad guys than good guys, suddenly the tide of battle changes wildly. I think one of the reasons people tell me that they're having a hard time challenging their players is because there simply aren't enough actions happening on the bad guy's turn, and an easy way to increase the number of actions without really adding that much bookkeeping is just throw in some minions. Also, if you pick up the 4th edition Monster Manual, which if you like these ideas, I'm recommending you do. I'm pretty sure you can get it on the DM's Guild. There'll be a link in the doobly-doo. I don't make any money off this stuff, by the way. Whenever I link to other people's products in my videos, it's purely because I use them and like them. For instance, when I was running gnolls against the heroes in 5th edition, I missed some of the cool stuff gnolls could do in 4th edition, so I just grabbed the ability from 4th edition and dropped it into 5th. Specifically, I stole an ability called Quick Bite, which gnolls in 4th edition have, where if they attack you in melee and you are bloodied, which is a term from 4th edition that means at half hit points or lower, I really miss the bloodied condition. I still use it when I'm describing the state that bad guys are in. I tell the players, okay, this character is bloodied now, and they're like, ooh, they're at half hit points. If you are at half hit points and a gnoll attacks you in melee, it goes into a blood frenzy and it gets a free bite attack against you. Of course, gnolls use weapons. They have spears and axes and stuff like that, but having the gnoll get a free attack on you once you're bloodied reminds the players that gnolls are also these ferocious, feral demon dogs. What tends to happen is the players are fighting the gnolls for a round or two. They think things are going well, but then one of the heroes drops below half hit points, and now when the gnolls attack that hero starts to take more damage, and what the heroes thought of as being an easy battle suddenly changes into being a much more challenging battle. And again, Quick Bite, the idea that you get a free attack, the gnolls get a free bite attack if they're attacking a bloodied hero, I did not find that overly complex. One of the things I loved about 4th edition, and we see a little bit of this in 5th edition, is how some of the abilities of bad guys work. Like when a Medusa, I thought this was brilliant. When a Medusa in 4th edition turns you to stone, here's how it works. The Medusa uses its gaze attack. Everybody in the area who can see has to make a saving throw. If they fail their saving throw, they're slowed. They're not instantly turned to stone. That would be awful. It sucks to fail a saving throw and instantly die. That's something that 4th edition addressed, is the save or die mechanic isn't really fun. I think 5th edition backpedaled on this a little bit. You failed your save against the Medusa's gaze, so on your turn you are slowed. At the end of that turn, you get to make a saving throw. If you succeed, you've shaken off the Medusa's gaze and you're fine. If you fail your save, now you get worse and you are immobilized. You can't move. On your next turn, you do nothing, and at the end of that turn, you make another saving throw. If you succeed, once again, you've shaken it off, and you are not affected by the Medusa's gaze. If you fail that second saving throw, however, you turn to stone. and are actually dead. And that, when I saw that, I thought that was phenomenal because that, first of all, it's dramatic and it's cool. The idea that something bad happens and if you don't save, it starts getting worse. But it also takes several rounds to do, which means the other players have many opportunities to help you. Let's imagine one of your players wants to play a bard and thinks it would be cool to be from a different college than the ones described in the player's handbook, and they have a really neat idea. The College of Wit or the College of Playwrights, and they use a lot of sarcasm and biting words in their spellcasting. And you think, that's a cool idea, but what spell do I use? How do I make this work? I would just steal a bard ability from 4th edition. I would steal this ability. I would steal something like Fast Friends, which is a cool 4th edition bard ability. You can either just grant something like this to the player as a badge of station. If you are a member of this college, the College of Wit, and you're a certain level, you just get to do this, let's say, once per encounter. Or if that kind of language seems weird and alien to you, just say it's a spell called Fast Friends, and here's how it works. You cast it on an enemy, and if the enemy fails their saving throw, you pick either you or one of your allies, and that enemy cannot attack you or that ally on their next turn. That can make a huge difference, especially against someone like Sordak the Lava Lord, but it only lasts for one round, so it's not hugely unbalancing, and the narrative for that is fantastic. You trick the monster into thinking that you're on his side. I can 100% imagine someone like Scanlan doing that. Saying something funny or sarcastic and tricking the monster into thinking that they are on the monster's side or their ally is not with us and one of our enemies, so the monster ignores them or you and doesn't attack. Using just simple stuff like who can attack who and positioning on the battlefield, 4th edition gave bards lots of really cool abilities. If I remember correctly, there was one called, and I think he called you stupid too, where the bard tries to trick the monster into attacking one of his allies. Narratively, it's very easy to imagine how something like that would work, with someone like Scanlan saying something clever and funny to a bad guy, tricking them into thinking that their ally is not an ally for a minute and has said something insulting to them. Something like Fast Friends I would award as an ability to a bard or a newly unlocked spell if the bard did something cool. I do that all the time, and it makes the players feel special. And of course, again, my players didn't play 4th edition, so they don't know I've stolen all this stuff from another game. One of my favorite things about 4th edition was the class the Warlord, which you get a little bit of, a very tiny taste of in the Battlemaster, but the Warlord was amazing. I loved playing one, I loved having one in my game, and I was really sad to see them deprecate that in 5th edition. I'm not sure why they did it. This is one of my favorite abilities. It shows you a lot about what was cool about 4th edition. This is called Fearless Rescue. It's gray, and we'll explain what that means. It means basically you could do this once per day. A Warlord is a fighting character. He's a leader. That's a type of character, not a class. He's a type of character in 4th edition, and his job is not only to fight, but also empower his allies so that they are better fighters, and because he's a leader, he can heal people in combat. That is the hallmark of the leader role in 4th edition. All leaders in 4th edition can heal people in combat. I actually used this, my character Ottavio de Caserta, who is one of my favorite characters, used this in my friend Jordi's campaign. It's a reaction when one of your allies goes unconscious. The Warlord gets the opportunity to immediately, as a reaction, run to that ally. Ideally, and you'll see why, ideally provoking many attacks of opportunity on the way. The more attacks of opportunity the Warlord provokes, the more heroic the rescue is. Then, once he reaches his downed comrade, he heals his friend for a certain amount of hit points, and he gets a bonus to his healing for every attack of opportunity he provoked. He is literally more effective the more heroic and courageous he is. We found lots of amazing combinations between like the Warlord and the Fighter, where my friend Jim was playing a fighter and he would mark a bad guy. I'll explain what that does in a second. And then I, the Warlord, would give that enemy a free attack on me. That was one of my Warlord's abilities. I would say, you want some? Come get some. And if that bad guy took the attack of opportunity I was granting them for free, then I got the opportunity to grant someone else in my party a free attack. But Jim had marked that character, and marking them meant that if they attacked somebody else, the fighter got a free attack on him. He got two attacks! When we discovered this in the game, we were like, holy crap, this is amazing. Remember, I gave my friend Silvano, when he was playing a paladin, I said, once he had served Saint Isolde and prayed to her and gotten her blessing, I made him the Knight Exorcist. You can imagine a war cleric in your party or a battlemaster in your party doing something amazing and heroic and you granting them the ability of a knight commander and giving them an ability like this. It was a title and it came with some cool abilities, including stuff from 4th edition. Trust me, your player would think that was amazing. This is maybe the first video I've made where I legitimately think, like, if Matt Mercer watched this, he would go, that is a cool idea, I want to steal it. Because I don't think he played a lot of 4th edition. This brings us to the middle of the video.
It wasn't, they'll be miles away by now, and I expect you left all of the blame.
As usual. Hello, good evening, and welcome to the middle of the film.
Well, Whoa. So at this point, you've had some reaction to the stuff I've been talking about, and you either think, wow, that stuff sounds really cool, in which case, hie thee hence to the DM's Guild and pick up the 4th edition Player's Handbook and the Monster Manual, or you think, this sounds like crap, the game's already complex enough, this stuff doesn't sound like fun, in which case, all we're going to do for the rest of the video is talk about kind of the history of 4th edition and what I loved about it. I just think that 4th edition is a great resource for 5th edition Dungeon Masters because there are so many amazing things to steal from it, and you can award things to your players, you can enhance your monster's abilities, and if your players haven't played 4th edition, they will just think that you are a genius and your game is awesome. So let's talk more generally about 4th edition. I loved it, but keep in mind that I started in 1986. I think we can actually pinpoint the month I started. It's whatever month this Dragon magazine came out. And I loved Advanced Dungeons & Dragons. And then I loved 2nd edition Dungeons & Dragons. And then I loved 3rd edition Dungeons. I played each of these editions for years. But one of the things that happened, and it happened with 4th edition, with almost all of these editions, was eventually I got tired of, I accumulated exasperation. I fell in love for various reasons, and so there was a honeymoon period, and then we played for years after that and really liked it, but then typically with 1st edition, because it was such a randomly undesigned game, lots of crazy tables, systems that didn't make any sense because they were just making it up as they went along. 2nd edition was the only edition of the game that I never really got burned out on, we just moved on to other games. 3rd edition we definitely got burned out on because just of the weight of the rules, and a lot of 4th edition. In order to understand the history of 4th edition, you need to sort of understand what was going on in 3rd edition. 3rd edition, by the way, which many, many people still play. I think maybe 3rd edition is the most popular because of Pathfinder, which anytime you hear people talk about D&D, someone's going to mention Pathfinder. Pathfinder is basically a house rule, homebrewed version of 3rd edition. 3rd edition is probably still one of the most popular editions of D&D thanks to stuff like Pathfinder, but it was an incredibly robust game. It was the most designed edition of D&D. And when I first saw it, my friends and I fell in love with it. We fell in love with how robust the design was. What do I mean by robust? Let me explain. This is the text for how to grapple somebody in 3rd edition. This is intense. It is extensive. It takes a long time to read. It is somewhat difficult to understand. It has many, many steps in it. But as you read each step, it makes perfect sense. It is logical, it is well thought out, and at each stage you say, yeah, I understand why it would work that way. This is how grappling works in 4th edition. And by the way, I think this is basically how it works in 5th edition. This is over 1,000 words long. It's like 1,140 words long. This is only 300 words long. As a result, because this is so much more complex, what happened was, at least in my group and the people I played with, and I played 3rd edition with lots of people, we basically just never grappled anybody. Simply, literally for the simple reason that we didn't want to have to look it up and read it again because it was kind of a pain in the ass. So even though we loved 3rd edition and played it every week, played it for hundreds of hours, thousands of hours, played it for years, even though I loved that edition of the game, it was exasperating. We just stopped looking up some of the rules because they were so complex. It's not just that there were many rules, and any edition of D&D is going to have many rules because it's covering an incredibly wide array of possible things you can do. It was also, each rule was very well thought out, but very complex. 4th edition, therefore, was an attempt to take a game like this and turn it into a game like this. If you are somebody who was burned out on this, then you loved 4th edition. I was one of those people. I think it's safe to say there were thousands, hundreds of thousands of players who they were perfectly happy with this, so they had no interest in this. And this was back under a regime where it was assumed that there should only be one edition of D&D and they would only support that edition. So once they came out with 4th edition, they threw out 3rd edition. People didn't like that. Wizards of the Coast has a very different policy now. It doesn't matter what edition of D&D you like, almost all of the content for that edition is available online in PDF form, which I personally find more useful. I know people love print products, but I can't carry all of my print products on my iPad, and I can't search a print product the way I can a PDF. Searchable PDFs, amazing. So 4th edition comes out. My friends and I loved it because, as I said, we were really, really tired of dealing with this stuff. We just had rules fatigue. Whereas 4th edition felt fun and fresh, it was exciting, it was dynamic, combat was super interesting. Combat wasn't any faster, you spent just as much time in combat, you just did way more cool stuff without having to spend as much time looking things up. 4th edition was the first edition of the game that assumed a grid. It assumed everything in 4th edition is expressed in terms of the grid. Instead of saying that your movement per round is 30 feet, it said 6 squares. Now, this made life a lot easier for people like me because I've been playing with miniatures and on a grid since 1986. My friend Jim, you saw in the interview, he'd been playing with miniatures on a grid since 1974. But of course there are people who play without a grid because they don't have access to minis and they don't know about this stuff. Those people found 4th edition kind of a pain in the butt. You can play 4th edition without minis and a grid, but that's not how it was designed to be used. Let's just say that. Also, I guess I should say I have a very low tolerance for edition warring, as you would expect from someone who has loved every edition of D&D. There were many people out there for whom 4th edition became a kind of shibboleth. Being critical of it in a toxic way became a badge of honor among a certain kind of D&D geek. I find that stuff completely loathsome. And if I see any of that stuff in the comments, I am going to delete it. For instance, a comment I am sure I'm going to be deleting in the comments is people saying that 4th edition was just an attempt to lure World of Warcraft players away, and they made the game like a video game. Now, I know some of the guys that worked on 4th edition. I used to work for them, and I can tell you that is not true. There's an interview somewhere online with Bill Slavisek, who used to be my boss's boss, and he talks about how, of course, they all played World of Warcraft and there were things they liked in there that they stole, but he then goes on to say they steal from every game they love. But people took that, specifically they went and found that and took that to mean, aha, see, it's transparently just an attempt to make D&D more like an MMO. But that is an ahistorical approach to 4th edition, and the more you understand about how 4th edition was born and what needs it was designed to service, I think the more interesting 4th edition becomes and the more fun it is. 4th edition was so far the only edition that was really designed to facilitate online play. It was designed to launch with an official Wizards of the Coast virtual tabletop like Fantasy Grounds. But unlike Fantasy Grounds, where they have to reprogram it every time there's a new rule for 5th edition, because these guys don't make 5th edition, the Wizards of the Coast virtual tabletop was going to be built from the ground up for 4th edition. Because, and I deeply admire Wizards of the Coast for doing this, they realized that in that day and age, there were many people who wanted to play D&D, who had played D&D when they were teenagers or in college, but it was many years later, and all of those friends were now dispersed around the country. Or, it is the modern age, they have friends on Twitter or Facebook or in the games they play who they would love to play a game like D&D with, but there's no way to do it because that person's in Sweden or Maine. I realize I just said Maine as though it is a far distant and exotic land. I apologize to any of you mainlanders. That's the reason so much of 4th edition works the way it does, and that's one of the reasons 4th edition is so different from every other edition. They wanted your character, for one thing, to be portable. What does that mean? Every earlier edition of D&D, there was this fantasy. You listen to the interview with Jim, and he talks about the idea that if you were playing in a D&D campaign, there would be lots of players, many DMs. When you got together to play, you would break up into groups, and it was sort of assumed DMs in the original edition of D&D did not invent worlds. They made dungeons. And the idea was all these dungeons all existed in the kind of shared universe. So you could take your 5th level character from Jim's game and go play it in Lisa's game. That's the dream, and if you read something like Knights of the Dinner Table, which I designed the first official card game for, you see these players talking about that all the time. You would go to a convention to play competitive D&D, which I have done, and you would want to play your character that you had brought with you. And that is obviously problematic, because you could just say, oh yes, of course my 3rd level paladin has a +5 Holy Avenger because my DM gave it to me. That's ridiculous. That is not portable. The dungeon master in that new game is going to say, well, your old DM is an idiot. This was a common problem, especially in the 70s and the 80s, where there were a lot of people playing D&D. People wanted their character to belong to them, not the campaign. 4th edition actually succeeded at that, because it was basically impossible to build a broken 4th edition character. I know that sounds crazy, but they did it. And one of the ways they did it, and the thing about 4th edition that I do not like, is the fact that they made magic items and money, rewards, basically meaningless. Magic items add very tiny bonuses to your character, and those bonuses are mathematically predictable. It is assumed once you hit 5th level that you have a magic item that gives you +1 to your attack roll. In fact, if the DM doesn't award those things, the math starts to break down in 4th edition. One of the side effects of this is that in any other edition of D&D, if your character goes through the Temple of Elemental Evil and my character goes through against the Cult of the Reptile God, we come out the other end very different characters. You have different items than I do. We look at our character sheets and I go, whoa, where did you get that? That is cool. Where did you find the Sword of Answering? Well, that's an item that only exists in the Temple of Elemental Evil, and it's super cool, and it radically changes how powerful your character is. That idea that a magic item might radically change, significantly improve the utility of your character is antithetical to 4th edition, because they want to avoid situations where a dungeon master awards you some ridiculous magic item that you shouldn't have, or actually what they were trying to avoid was you cheating and showing up at someone else's game saying, no, this is a perfectly legal character, my other DM approved it. So every 4th edition character can be easily reverse engineered, and you can see where all their points went, all the decisions they made. The only difference between your 7th level warlord and my 7th level warlord were the legal choices we made during character creation and when we leveled up. And there are many choices, so your character is going to be very different from mine, but not because of the magic items they got. And that was something that really bummed me out, because I like that feeling of, as you know, seeding the world with lots of different adventures and letting the players go where they want, and the players being motivated by enlightened self-interest, otherwise known as greed. I wanted money to be a big deal. I wanted players to be able to build strongholds and stuff like that. Of course, I had my own stronghold rules, which I had developed years and years before, and we deployed those. But in 4th edition, money is much less useful than other editions. In fact, there is actually advice in the Dungeon Master's Guide for 4th edition that says, you know what, just ask your players what magic items they want and then give them to them. Because the system in 4th edition was designed that if you awarded the player a magic item they didn't want, they could melt it down into something called residuum and then marry it with some gold and make the magic item they did want. That being the case, why not just award them the magic item they wanted in the first place? Now, I don't think that's a bad idea, but it was ill-suited for the kind of game I like, that notion of why are we going to the Temple of Elemental Evil? Because there's treasure there. It is, however, I think exceptionally well-suited for a game like a Lord of the Rings game, where the players are heroic characters that are trying to save the world. They're not exploring for greed. They don't just want cash and cool magic items. They want to save the world. And actually, I think the game that Matt Mercer runs, the Vox Machina game, I think is that kind of game. If that's the kind of game you want to run, if you want to run a heroic game where the stakes are high and the players are acting altruistically, then I think 4th edition is still an excellent game. I would still use it for that. It's the only edition of the game I would go back to, but only under certain specific circumstances. Another thing Wizards of the Coast fixed with 4th edition, which they then threw out, people complained a lot about it, they fixed it, and then they complained about the fix, was something called linear fighters. This is from Monty Cook, by the way. I believe he came up with this term, linear fighters and quadratic wizards. What does that mean? It means that a fighter improves very slowly over time, and really a fighter in any other edition of the game basically only gets better in the sense that they do more damage. Fifth edition does a pretty good job of fixing this with stuff like the Battlemaster getting more maneuvers and the Eldritch Knight getting more spells, but Nicodemus, my friend EJ, plays Eldritch Knight in my game, and the spells are neat, but really all they're doing is enhancing the circumstances under which and the way he does damage. This is a problem Gary Gygax was dealing with all the way back in the original edition of the game. It's the reason he was constantly patching the rules, trying to keep fighters up with wizards. He made it so that a fighter, and only a fighter, if a fighter has an 18 strength, they get access to a special range of strength benefits. The percentile strength system, where you can end up with a much higher bonus to hit and damage than anyone else with an 18 strength. Only fighters could do that. Fighters also get access to a thing called weapon specialization, which gives them more attacks per round. Even back in the 70s and 80s, the only solution Gary had to this problem, it was a known problem, was giving the fighter more attacks, more damage, higher strength. But that's not a solution, because eventually the wizard can, like, bend time and space and cast a wish. That's an extreme example, but you don't need... This actually happened to my party, my group, when I played back in the 90s. It happened all the time. My friend Dave, playing a fighter, would be constantly frustrated that really all he could do was attack more often, attack more effectively, but the wizard could do things like cast hold person. And when that happened in reverse, and he was the person being held, he did not like that, because he felt like his options were much, much narrower than the wizard's. He felt that way because they were. Well, 4th edition is... As far as I'm concerned, the only edition of the game to solve that problem, and it did it in a way that some people liked, I liked it, some people hated. Fourth edition's solution to this was to say, everybody, all classes, all have the same number of cool abilities they can use in every battle. In other words, they threw out the idea that wizards cast spells, and clerics and wizards and spellcasters have access to this whole other game mechanic, spellcasting, that the martial characters don't have, and they said, everyone always has cool abilities they can use in battle, and they called these abilities powers. That was probably a bad name, because their goal was to make characters feel heroic, and a first level 4th edition character is, I think, much more capable and, frankly, interesting than a first level D&D 5 character. But calling them powers meant people felt like they were superheroes in a way they felt was out of genre for a Dungeons & Dragons Conan-style game. Whatever else we think is true of Conan, we don't think of him as having superpowers, and using the term powers in 4th edition, I think, poisoned the well for some people. They felt like, oh, I don't want to be somebody that has powers. I don't want to play a superhero. I didn't have that problem. I thought it was super cool. To give you an idea of what I'm talking about, a wizard in 4th edition can cast sleep just like a wizard in 5th edition can. This is what the spell sleep looks like in 5th edition. This is what it looks like in 4th edition. You're seeing the trend here, right? Grapple in 3rd edition was ridiculously long. In 4th edition was really straightforward. The sleep spell in 5th edition is quite long. Sleep in 4th edition was really straightforward. You know how sleep works in 5th edition. Actually, I quite like this mechanic. I think it's very clever. I think it's interesting and fun to use. Although, every time someone in my game has tried to use sleep, they have been confused, and I've had to explain it to them. We'll talk about that in a second. But sleep in 4th edition works in a very similar way, but I think is much more straightforward. It's an area effect spell. Everyone in the area has to make a saving throw. But like a dragon's breath weapon, where you take damage even if you save, even characters in the area of the sleep who make their saving throw are slowed. They're drowsy as they try to shake off the effects of the spell. If you fail your saving throw, you're also slowed. You get a chance to save at the end of your round. If you fail that saving throw, you fall unconscious. Notice there's no die rolling here. There's a lot of die rolling in the 5th edition version, which I like. Players like rolling dice, don't get me wrong. But again, this is more complex. And every time a player has tried to cast sleep for the first time in my game in 5th edition, I have to they've read the rules. They don't understand it. I have to explain it to them. It's a cool idea, but it has to be explained. Here in the 4th edition version, it's relatively straightforward. Everyone is slowed as they all get drowsy. The people who fail their save, if they fail again, they fall unconscious. This is how a wizard's spell works in 4th edition, but everyone in 4th edition has abilities like this. If you look in the doobly-doo, you'll find links to PDFs for two character sheets from 4th edition, a 3rd level fighter and a 3rd level wizard, because I wanted you to be able to see how characters in 4th edition worked. In both cases, they had lots of powers, and when you printed your character sheet out, you would get sheets of powers, and they were meant to be card-sized. We would cut them out, put them on cards. You'll notice the cards, the powers, are color-coded. The green ones meant you can do this every round. You never run out of this. A fighter can use his green powers, his at-will powers is what they're called, every round, never runs out of them. To give you an example, this is a at-will power that a fighter gets at first level, which means, since you can tell it's green, that means the fighter can do this every round, they never run out of it. It's an attack. If they hit, they do their weapons damage, and they push the enemy back one square and have the opportunity, if they want to follow up. Positioning, because it's played on a grid, positioning is huge in 4th edition. The ability to move bad guys around and then move yourself around, or move your allies around, depending on the ability, is super useful. Because a first level fighter in 4th edition has a couple of abilities like this, there's really never a time where you just swing your sword. You never just roll to attack and then do damage. That's not how characters work in 4th edition. And in fact, I played with at least one person who found that really confusing. We played for years, and they never really wrapped their head around the fact that it was their turn. If all they wanted to do was attack, they should be using one of their at-will powers rather than just, they would always default back to rolling a 20-sided die and then wanting to roll damage. And we would stare at this player and say, "What are you doing?" And they would have to be reminded. This was not a stupid person. They would just, it was not what they were used to. It was not their default assumption. They would have to constantly be reminded that there was always, always a better option than just swinging your sword and doing damage. This was such a problem, by the way, that eventually they released a kind of 4.5 edition of the game called Essentials, which was fully backwards compatible. And they had different classes. They had new classes. And one of the points, they had a new fighter class you could play. And the new fighter class was like, their powers were basically choosing, if all you wanted to do was swing your sword and do damage, go ahead and do that. And then you had like different auras that you projected that granted your allies different abilities, different cool abilities. So you turned on one of these auras, your allies got some cool fighting abilities, and you could just swing your sword and do damage for the rest of the battle and be happy. For instance, this is one of the things that a fighter can do once per day. It's a gray power. That means it's a daily action. They can only do it once per day. It's called flanking assault. The fighter attacks an enemy, and if they hit, not only do they do damage, they do extra damage for every ally that is adjacent to that bad guy. Stuff like this is super cool. I use this stuff still in 5th edition, but this language of at-will powers and encounter powers, things you can only do once per encounter, daily powers that you could do once per day. Some of the players, some veteran players, 3rd edition players, older players, they didn't like this language because it was explicitly gamist. 4th edition was not shy. Remember, it was designed to be played with a virtual tabletop. It was not shy about the fact that it was a game. It did not use natural language. That's the difference between this and this. This uses natural language. And one of the things this does, which I like, don't get me wrong, one of the things that having spells work this way does is it makes it feel when you, it's a subconscious thing. It makes you feel when you're reading this that you're reading how the spell in the world works. Whereas when you read this, you have no illusions that this is how characters in the world think. This is explicitly game mechanics. That's something people didn't like. They didn't like losing that illusion that they, when they read the rules of Dungeons and Dragons, they were reading the rules of a world. They didn't like, they didn't enjoy feeling like they were playing a game. That language, daily powers, encounter powers, at-will powers, people didn't like that because it wasn't natural. It codified things that had been true in D&D for a long time, just like roles. We'll talk about that in a second. The notion that I'm going to cast a spell on myself and it only lasts 10 minutes. Most players find that to be perfectly reasonable because it uses natural language. You can imagine a wizard describing it that way in the world, but in 4th edition, they would just say, it's an encounter power. Because how often do you have more than one encounter in 10 minutes? They are functionally equivalent, but because 4th edition uses a term that is explicitly gamist, some people didn't like it. I had no problem translating 4th edition powers and abilities into narrative effects and stuff. In fact, I found 4th edition powers a lot easier to narrate than I swing my sword and do damage from 5th edition. Same thing with roles. Each class fell into one of four roles. And D&D had always had roles like this. You always wanted, back in 1974, if you had somebody who rolled well on their starting wealth and they ended up able to afford plate mail, you would put that character in the front of the party. And they called that character a tank. That notion that that character has a job, apart from whatever it says on your character sheet, you're a fighter, you do this much damage. If you're in heavy armor and you have a lot of hit points, you have a job, and that is to stay in the front line and protect the squishy characters. Fourth edition took those jobs and codified them and gave them game mechanics, which, again, I liked. Unfortunately, in many people's eyes, a strike against 4th edition, they took the wizard, and instead of making the wizard what they would call a striker, a character that just does a ton of damage, they made the wizard a controller. A controller is something I think unique to 4th edition. It is someone whose job it is to control the battlefield, to change the shape and nature of the battlefield, to put slow zones. There's a great low-level wizard spell. It's called Grasping Shadows. It's a first-level encounter power, which means a first-level wizard can do this once per battle. You target an enemy, you do damage to them if you hit, and then all the squares around them turn into difficult terrain as these shadowy arms. It's kind of like Evard's Black Tentacles. Shadowy arms and skeletal arms come out of the ground and try to restrain them. It's very cool, it's very evocative, and that's something a controller does. A little bit of damage, but I've also now changed the nature of the battlefield so that bad guy can't maneuver into the place they want to maneuver into. Again, a highly tactical game like 4th edition, that is huge. This is a cool daily power, which means you can only do this once per day, so you know it's gotta be super powerful, that a first level wizard can do in 4th edition. It's called Phantom Chasm. You target an enemy, they take a lot of damage. Daily powers tend to do more damage than encounter powers or at-will powers. They take a lot of damage, and then they fall prone. They have literally fallen for the illusion that you have opened a chasm underneath them, and then the zone lasts, the Phantom Chasm. It's like an illusion, it's an illusionary spell. The Phantom Chasm lasts to the end of the battle, and any enemies that enter it immediately fall prone, no saving throw. You see what I mean? The idea that a wizard's job is to change the nature of the battlefield and prevent the enemy from being able to maneuver the way they want to. That is a super cool idea. Wizards are cool in 4th edition, but that is not what people wanted from wizards. They wanted to point at somebody and do a lot of damage. And I think the people at Wizards of the Coast probably should have anticipated that, and maybe making the wizard a striker that just does a ton of damage would have been more satisfying for people. But Wizards of the Coast attitude was like, well, that's what a sorcerer is for, then play a sorcerer. But people didn't like that. We talked before about my friend Jim's fighter character marking bad guys. Marking is one of the most controversial things in 4th edition. It was a brand new mechanic, and I think I've seen it once or twice in 5th edition. Marking is what made a defender, and a fighter in 4th edition is a defender. Fighters don't do tons of damage. There are other classes, other martial characters, where if you want to be somebody who looks and acts like a fighter but just does tons of damage, you would play them, like a ranger or a rogue. Marking is the thing that makes defenders defenders. All defenders have the ability to mark an enemy and say, if you attack anybody but me, I get an advantage against you. Different advantages depending on the class. I think fighters typically, they would get either a free attack on an enemy that they marked, or the enemy that they marked, if they attack somebody else, would have a penalty to hit. The idea is the fighter is getting in the enemy's face. He's so aggressive, he's so violent, he's so good at using his weapons that he's making it impossible for the enemy to ignore them. And I liked that idea. I thought it was super cool. It was a very good way. I mean, you can imagine a battle like Pox Machina against Sordak, the Lava Lord, where somebody like... Actually, now that I think about it, Pox Machina doesn't have a fighter, but it would be cool to be able to point at somebody like Sordak, the Lava Lord, and say, face me, and force Sordak to attack that person. It's not a charm. They're not literally for it. They can still, and this was one of the cool things about 4th edition, especially when you started mixing some of the classes. A character who is marked can still make the decision to attack other people. And this happened, you know, I would say 20 to 30% of the time in combat, I would make the decision, no, it is more advantageous for me to ignore the defender and attack this person. But that triggers all the defender's cool abilities. So it's not like mind control or anything like that. It's just that this character is so violent and so dangerous that you can't ignore them. And that I thought was a cool idea, but... people who had played a lot of MMOs felt like it was too similar to a thing called aggro from World of Warcraft, even though it is literally the opposite of aggro. Aggro is something you broadcast that attracts enemies, whereas marking is something you put on an enemy. And there were some characters, I think I remember my friend Mark, he was playing a paladin, and he died, which is, by the way, not easy in 4th edition, because he had a burst ability. Everyone in the area, every enemy in the area was marked. He thought he was saving the day by marking all of these enemies and forcing them to attack him, and in a certain sense, he was saving the day, just not his day. All the enemies then swarmed on top of him and annihilated him in a round. He was like, okay, I needed to have thought this out a little bit more. It was a cool ability, and it was a pretty dramatic thing, but sometimes be careful what you wish for, because you might get it. Another thing that some people found challenging, I remember my friend Phil didn't like it, was the fact that every character in 4th edition had self-healing. Every character in 4th edition could, once per battle, and you could do this every battle, they could take a round, do nothing, and recover some hit points. The idea is somebody like Rambo, who's been filled with bullets, takes his cigar and cauterizes the wounds like, ugh, and then they're ready to go. I thought that was dramatic. I thought it was a very clever way of making it. One of the great things about 4th edition, and I think they did a pretty good job of preserving this in 5th edition, was for the first time, you never had to choose between healing someone or aiding an ally and doing your cool thing against the enemies. Like a cleric, when a cleric heals somebody, it's typically after they've attacked, as part of an attack. And often when a cleric heals somebody, what they're doing is they're allowing them to spend their healing surges, just like in 5th edition, you're allowing them to spend hit dice. Just using the term hit dice in 5th edition, same mechanic, but calling it something else, I think made it seem more acceptable to legacy players, let's call them. There have always been hit dice in D&D, but they weren't used that way. But my friend Phil thought that was weird. It seemed to him like people had supernatural abilities, the ability to just stop and heal themselves and recover some hit points. They could only do this once per battle, but it seemed weird to him. He was never able to align the mechanic with the fantasy. And he wasn't alone. Lots of people felt that way. Unfortunately, the virtual tabletop for 4th edition, in a tragic set of circumstances we don't need to get in here, you can look it up online, never released. And so no one who played 4th edition ever really understood. In a certain sense, I've always felt like 4th edition was dead on arrival because we didn't get the other half of the package. We didn't get the virtual tabletop. And so no one really got a chance to play it the way it was meant to be played. That's 4th edition, by the way, is when my friends and I started using Fantasy Grounds. I think Fantasy Grounds has been around since the 90s, but 4th edition was, because it was such a tactical game, and I run a tactical game, I've been running a tactical game since 1986, because it was such a tactical game, if you played 4th edition over Fantasy Grounds, all of a sudden it came alive. You started noticing how much easier and how much more fun it was to run, not just then at the tabletop, than any other edition of D&D. If you watch the interview with my friend Jim, that's what he's talking about when he talks about how much fun it is to run. Only in 4th edition, by the way, they had these great online tools. I don't know if they're still available. My subscription still works. They had these great online tools, including a monster database with every monster in it for 4th edition. And you could just search for a monster that you liked based on criteria like, well, my players are, they're 12th level and they're in the plane of fire. So what is a 12th level fire type monster? And if you didn't find anything to your liking, you would just zero out the level thing and go, oh, here's a 20th level fire monster. You would grab that thing and just go down level, down level, down level, down level. And it would dynamically adjust the monster's stats until it was the level you wanted. That was brilliant. And it's the reason when my friends and I in 4th edition were raiding a gnome bank and successfully overcame all the obstacles getting to the vault, and my friend Jim wanted to challenge us in the vault, he looked through the monsters and he didn't even know this thing existed. I think it might have taken him a total of 3 minutes to do this. We did not feel like we were sitting there waiting for Jim to figure out what happened next. He was on my laptop and he was like, ooh, this is interesting. And he grabbed a treasure golem and just made it level appropriate by clicking a button a couple of times. And then we rolled initiative, and the cool thing about the treasure golem in 4th edition was it had a gaze attack, and if you failed your saving throw, you got dollar signs in your eyes and you turned and started attacking your allies. You started fighting over the treasure, and we were a party of dwarves. It was so perfect. It was something that, I mean, you could do something like that in any edition of the game, but 4th edition was the first edition where they did that. So I could easily steal something like that for 5th edition. Me describing this to you, you already probably know how you could steal something like that for 5th edition. So the online tools were fantastic, but we never got the virtual tabletop. So people complained about it. They felt like it felt video gamey. But what they were detecting, I think, was just Wizards of the Coast's desire for you to be able to play this game online with your friends from around the world, friends you haven't seen in a long time, and make everything consistent and regular so that the character you made in my game, you can go play in Jim's game, and Jim would have nothing to object to. The desire to make sure that every class had interesting options, that they didn't just swing their sword. Those things are things that are true in video games typically, but were never true in D&D before this, so D&D adding it, suddenly now it felt like a video game, but not to my friends and I, it just felt awesome. Unfortunately, even though people had complained about it leading up to 4th edition, when they took out quadratic wizards and they made all characters equally powerful at every level, people complained about that. They missed super powerful wizards and clerics and other spellcasters. So 5th edition put them back in. And again, I love 5th edition. I am sure I will be playing 5th edition for years. But if there's an edition of the game that I'm going to go back to and try again, I think about doing this every week. I think about starting a new 4th edition game. Often when my friends talk about running D&D, I may not say this, but I secretly hope they're going to run a 4th edition game. I think if you had never played D&D before and 4th edition was your first edition of the game, that you loved it. It was a fantastic game. It was incredibly well designed. It was a lot of fun. It made a lot of sense. For instance, my friends and I all read Penny Arcade, which is a famous webcomic about video games, and we're all game developers. And one of the guys behind Penny Arcade, Jerry, is famously a D&D player and has been for years and loves D&D. He's the writer. Of course he loves D&D. And the other guy behind Penny Arcade, Mike, would often give him shit about what a ridiculous game he thought it was. He hadn't played D&D, but just the act of getting together and role-playing seemed weird to him. Which, I mean, it is weird, but obviously it's also a lot of fun. Fourth edition was the game that hooked Mike. He played that and he loved it. He enjoying making fun of D&D to being an amazing DM. He would do some, because he was an artist, he would make these incredible set piece battles. I remember he posted once this battle on another plane where the players were going from world to world, these little tiny moonlets that had their own gravity, and he painted and drew grids on these styrofoam balls that allowed the players to stick their characters to it. He put a ton of work into his game. His players love it. He loved being a dungeon master. It was the game that hooked someone who thought D&D was silly. Then, unfortunately, when 5th edition came out, I remember they did a podcast where they tried to hook the guys at Penny Arcade, because obviously, if you have a popular webcomic and you are in favor of the new edition of D&D, you're helping out Wizards of the Coast. So Wizards of the Coast made a special visit to these guys and basically pitched them 5th edition. And the writer, who was used to new editions and was always going to be interested in whatever the new edition of D&D was doing, listened and was like, oh, this is super interesting. But the artist, for whom 4th edition was their first edition and he loved it, was like, why would I play 5th edition? And the funny thing was, I think the guys at Wizards of the Coast were so used to people complaining about 4th edition, legacy players complaining about 4th edition, that they had literally no answer. They couldn't think of anything that if you loved 4th edition, here's your reason to switch to 5th. They had no answer. It was almost as though they had never considered the question. That was somewhat disappointing. But to their credit, they released D&D 5 and the DM's Guild. And the DM's Guild, if you like 4th edition and you want to give it a try, all of the stuff for 4th edition is up there. In fact, it's a lot easier and cheaper to get into 4th edition now than it was when it came out. The PDFs are a lot cheaper. I'm certain at some point in this video I have said 4th edition when I meant 5th edition or vice versa, or I may have accidentally thrown a 3rd edition in there, but you get it. That's the 4th edition video, folks. Hopefully now you have some idea what 4th edition was about, why I liked it, why so many people seemed not to like it, and also how useful and fertile it can be if you want to steal cool stuff for your game. Notice that these abilities don't in any way affect the math of 5th edition. If you want to give the gnolls in your game Quick Bite, where they get an extra free attack if they're attacking a bloodied character, gnolls already have a bite attack in 5th edition. All you're doing is giving them a new opportunity to use it. And hopefully now you understand a little bit about how battles in 5th edition work, and the idea that whichever side is outnumbered is at a substantive disadvantage, a disadvantage that is not mathematically evident at first, just because of the way the action economy works. And now you understand a little bit about bounded accuracy and the idea that the numbers in 5th edition never really get that high. The goal thereby being to allow dungeon masters who want to keep using orcs against players to do it even when the player is 9th, 10th, 11th level. I use powers from 4th edition as rewards all the time. I use monster abilities from 4th edition all the time. I use minions, and I don't know why, apart from the fact that I think 5th edition assumes that if you're high enough level, this low level bad guy is effectively a minion because you're going to do so much damage to them. I still like using minions because there's like, that assumption does not hold true for things like orcs, for instance. Orcs have enough hit points that even a relatively high-level character, some of the orcs are going to survive more than one round of being attacked, and now you have to do bookkeeping. And the cool thing about minions is it gives the players this feeling of fighting a horde of bad guys without all the bookkeeping. You don't have to keep track of hit points. Anytime one of them takes damage, you take them off the field. Super fun, super useful, makes the heroes feel like badasses. And minions are a great and easy way to shore up an enemy who might otherwise just be a solo bad guy. I recommend specifically, if you're going to look at monster abilities, check out the Monster Vault for the 4th edition Essentials line. I think any monster book for 4th edition would be useful, but over time, as people played the game, they adjusted how they designed it to make it, you know, more balanced and more fun to play. And by the time you got to the Essentials products, like the Monster Vault, solo elite bad guys had many reactions, many things that they could do when it wasn't their turn, and that made them more fun to play. Remember that this is, I think, also a useful lesson. Anytime a bad guy has a life expectancy of 5 or 7 rounds or whatever, they need many different interesting things to do so the battle doesn't become a slog. One of the things that makes battles feel like a slog is the act of doing the same thing every round. So giving the bad guys more and more interesting things to do, especially things when it's not their turn, like when the bad guy is bloodied, they get this immediate rage attack, makes the combat more fun, and I don't think makes it that much more complex. Especially compared to something like giving them spells. Holy crap. That's the fourth edition video, folks. I hope you found it useful. I think, like I said, I think it might be one of the more useful videos I've made, depending on your experience with fifth edition. I want to give a shout out to one of my viewers, Ronick Cantrell, who sent me this ridiculously long, it's not really a letter, it's their campaign setting. What they did was this person took my notes for the Age of Chaos, my handout, and just reworked all of it to make it for their game, which I love. I love it when people take the stuff I have made, like we were talking about the Teeth of the Dragon, these artifacts for my D&D game on my subreddit. I love it when people take the stuff I have made and use it and repurpose it for their own stuff. He included his own map using Hexographer, which I think is super cool. And as a thank you, I do not encourage people doing this. I always feel a little weird when people send me presents, but I'm also super grateful. Thank you very much, Ronick. This is a cool, you know, a little Think Geek toy that is a mirror and it lights up. Look at that. It's an infinity mirror. So if you've been following my D&D campaign diary, you know that one of the groups in my game has a magical artifact that's a mirror, the Mirror of Gilmara. Isn't this the Mirror of Gilmara? I think it is. Thank you, Mr. Cantrell. I will put this to good use. I apologize if you've been waiting for D&D videos and not getting as many as you expected. I've been on vacation. I've been working on my Stronghold rules. Got a lot of work done on them. So look forward to these Stronghold rules sometime soon-ish. Hopefully, let's say in the next month. I've just promised you guys so much stuff. I'm highly mindful of the fact that I want to get it all to you. Long video, I think, but hopefully useful. If you want to help support the channel, as you know, I have no ads in front of my D&D content. I do not have a Patreon, but I do have an Amazon page in the doobly-doo. I am a fantasy author, an independent fantasy author. I've got two books out. I'm working on my third, and a lot of people have bought these books, and they seem to really like them. That makes me super happy. They're not that expensive. It's $4 a book, of which I see $3. If you buy both books, you're throwing me $6. I don't know what kind of stuff you like to read. Read the reviews online. See if it's your cup of tea. If so, give it a shot. And if you read them, please come by my subreddit and let me know what you thought. Lots of people do that. I love talking to people about the books. Of course I do. Why wouldn't I? Lots more D&D videos to come, folks. Don't worry. We'll finish the politics series and we'll do more adventures and campaign settings and all sorts of neat stuff. But I basically want to make sure that I'm always thinking, here's the stuff I've promised, but are any of these the most useful thing I can think of for a new DM, for somebody who's dungeon mastering 5th edition? I always want to make sure that there's new content here that is as useful as possible. And I thought the stuff in 4th edition is super useful. This advice on why the numbers in D&D work the way they do and how to run combat, why combat works the way it does, and what kind of stuff you can steal for 4th edition, I really felt would be useful. Let me know what you think. Until next time, peace out. Oh, speaking of people supporting the channel, I got a new lens for my camera. The Rogue One video was the first time you saw that. So some people noticed that there was a marked difference, a noticeable difference in the video quality. Really what you're noticing is the fact that this lens is much less fiddly than the old lens. This is the old lens. It is literally half the size and weight of the entire camera. It's the lens that came with the camera and it is designed, it's called a power zoom lens. It's designed to be useful really up close and really, really far away. It's kind of crazy. Obviously, I don't shoot under those conditions. I'm always about 30 inches away from the lens. So I got a lens that is specifically for that, and it makes it so that it takes less time and effort to set up the lens, and I don't have to worry about accidentally, this happened all the time with the old lens, accidentally monkeying with it and throwing the focus off and recording a whole video that was out of focus. Oh my God. You also may notice there's no microphone here. Woo! This is the old microphone. I got a new microphone. It's up here on a boom. This is my old Heil PR40. It used to sit right here. I tried to keep it out of shot, but it often came into shot. The Heil PR40 has done me well these many years. It's a great microphone. If you're podcasting, if you're doing any recording, I can strongly recommend it. It's a little expensive. I think it's about $300, but gosh, it's worth it. I love the audio quality, and you'll probably notice that the audio quality of this video is not as good, probably, as the new, more expensive mic. Doesn't sound as good yet, simply because I haven't used it as much yet. It took me months to figure out how to get the best sound out of this thing and just learn audio production. The problem with the Heil PR40 is not only is it I had to put it as close as possible to my face, which meant I couldn't have a pop filter, which meant every time there was a plosive in my dialogue, you heard it in the microphone. That was super annoying. But also the fact that on the device I use to record, something like this, for instance, there's a little knob on here that says gain. And with the Heil PR40, there was literally one setting on the gain knob that was correct. A millimeter in the other direction, and suddenly I was blowing out and redlining. A millimeter in the other direction, and suddenly you couldn't hear me. And I thought this was a bug, and that's one of the reasons I got this thing. But after loaning the Heil PR40 to one of my audio nerd friends at Turtle Rock Studios, they said, oh, no, no, that's just the way this mic is. The phrase used was, it's just picky. But it sounded great. This mic is much less picky, and it's probably going to take several videos for me to figure out how to get the best sound out of it. This mic is a Sennheiser MKH416, which is a Sirius microphone. And it's on a boom, which means I should sound pretty good, and I have no microphone here. Oh, it's so nice. These are the kinds of things I can do because you support my channel by buying the books. These are all things I do to make recording easier and more straightforward, and make setup easier, and make it so that the tolerances of the device that I'm using get broader and broader over time, which means they're not as frustrating to use. I just want to make sure that folks understand that their support is going to a good cause. Okay, for real this time, that's it. Peace out for real.